Well, I have many moments in my childhood.
Every moment of our lives is a chance to understand what matters.
I had a childhood where I spent a tremendous amount of time in the outdoors.
And these are moments that matter.
I remember when I was a kid, probably 8 or 9, and my dad took me on my first deer hunt.
We lived up around 5 different lakes, so I spent every day during the summer down on the lake fishing.
There are moments we'll always remember.
And I remember sitting there and this bobcat came out in the Sendera, and it was just magical, and I've been hooked ever since.
There are memories in the making.
Being able to hunt my first birds.
Stories we'll share with friends and pass down to our children of family fun, outdoor adventure, and amazing places with abundant wildlife.
I have so many of those moments. It's really what helped shape me as a person.
Those moments are made possible by moments like these. Every day, all across North America, state wildlife agencies are leading heroic efforts to restore endangered species, repair critical habitat, and maintain our nation's natural abundance of fish and wildlife for generations to come.
States really are the cornerstone for fish and wildlife conservation across our country, really always have been. They're the laboratories of innovation. States are the champions of America's fish and wildlife. We're the voice, we're the ambassador, the caretakers and stewards of this extraordinary assemblage of fish and wildlife and outdoor recreation that we've inherited and that we want to pass on to future generations.
The leaders of those state agencies and their federal and private partners in conservation must realize they stand on the shoulders of giants. Giants of conservation and American democracy who made the most of their moments on Earth. Those fathers of this great nation who designed a government that gets its power from the people, and those founders of a system of conservation that we call the North American model.
The North American model grew out of the concept of democracy. People own the wildlife, and therefore it is their responsibility to manage the wildlife scientifically, not politically.
It's a system that recognizes wildlife as a natural resource belonging not to the government or the crown, but to the people who are its rightful owners.
As we built the country and we defined the authorities between the federal government and the states, under public trust doctrine, the wildlife became under the state authority.
Public trust doctrine gives states the privilege and the responsibility to hold wildlife in trust for the people.
It is fundamental to the democratic federalist principles that the states manage the wildlife for the people. That is a product and a function of this great democracy that was established here, right here, 200 years ago.
Of course, most people have never heard of the North American model or how it evolved over the last century. They're not aware of the Pittman-Robertson Act or other mechanisms of sportsman-funded conservation. Few Americans would recognize the names of conservation trailblazers Gifford Pinchot and George Bird Grinnell. And those who do speak of Theodore Roosevelt and Aldo Leopold likely know only the trimmings of their contributions to the most successful conservation system the world has ever known.
Look at all of them out there. It's amazing.
But people do appreciate wildlife. And as heirs to North America's wildlife legacy, they're fortunate to have conservation leaders who understand their critical role in the world today.
These jobs are an extraordinary privilege. There's no doubt about that. That's absolutely undeniable. But these jobs are not about being a director. They're really about being a steward. They're about being a champion and enabler for this extraordinary group of professionals that are biologists and technicians and game wardens and communication specialists and outdoor recreation professionals, and helping to inspire them to do more for our home ground.
For more than 100 years, state conservation leaders have had a huge role in transforming this continent. From one that exploited and exhausted its precious natural resources, to one that's blessed with a wealth of wildlife, thanks to sustainable, science-based management and conservation. Yet today, conservation is at a crossroads, just as it was back in 1902. That's when wildlife managers from six of the 31 states that had game and fish agencies met in Yellowstone Park to form an alliance that would give them a stronger voice and greater influence in the national conservation arena. That modest gathering evolved into what is now the Association of Fish and Wildlife Agencies. It's a collective of all 50 state agencies, three U.S. territories, and political subdivisions of Canada and Mexico working together on behalf of their citizens and the wildlife they hold dear.
You know, it came together to really bring states together and be able to speak with one voice so that we could speak clearly and we could speak loudly on the issues that really impacted us. That's probably more essential today than it's ever been.
No doubt, there's a litany of challenges, and they're big. As I reflect on 20 or 25 years in this profession, the challenges that we confront, they're bigger, they're more complex, and really at scales that are absolutely unprecedented in what we've seen in the past. And so that creates enormous challenges for us. It also creates enormous opportunities.
Opportunities to draw on the source of past success, so that one-time challenges become a brighter future.
When I look back on the history of wildlife conservation, there are special moments in time that are unique, that are turning points that 50 or 100 years from now, people will write about. Today, right now, this is one of those moments.
Once again, North America is looking for leaders to define a path forward.
We have to think about what's going to need in 100 years. And that's what's probably the biggest challenge and could be the biggest missed opportunity, that we get so focused on the problems of today that we don't change and anticipate the needs of 100 years from now.
When times get tough, this is what we've got to remember. This is what we've got to keep in mind. Our future generations, we do it for them. The kids, Sammy and Marilyn Joe, these grandkids, and all of the kids in our country, just like this. Right, kids?
Yeah.
Crawdad.
If our nation's wildlife legacy is to prevail through the 21st century, our conservation leaders will have to seize the moment.
Every moment does matter. But I think it's less about thinking about those moments as a defining moment than thinking about the fact that the work we do is measured in generational scales. We are planting the proverbial tree to have shade for somebody that's not even born yet. The defining moments in conservation are usually identified after the fact. We always need to be looking forward.